Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to the Institute of Divine Metaphysical Research. Now, this is a school, and it is not a church, and neither are we affiliated with a church or a religious organization. This school is a nonprofit, non-denominational, religious, and scientific research organization dedicated to proving the existence of Yahweh, or Elohim, and the operation of the eternal pattern, purpose, and plan operating throughout eternity unto this present day. Now, this school is the result of a divine panoramic vision and revelation given to our founder, Dr. Henry Clifford Kenley, in the state of Ohio in the year 1931. And we're incorporated in the state of California in the year 1958. Since that time, we have established branch schools throughout the United States, Canada, and certain other foreign countries. The Ontario Branch School was established in May of 1988. Now, in the school, we use and teach by the true and original names and titles for the Father, the Word of Son, and the Holy Spirit, which are contained in the original Hebrew text. The true name for the Heavenly Father is Yahweh. It has been improperly substituted by Lord. The true title for the Word or Son is Elohim. It has also been improperly substituted by God. And the true name for the Holy Spirit manifested in or out of a physical body is Yahshua. It has been erroneously substituted by Jesus Christ. Our Lord and God, they are titles and not names. The Apostle Paul, filled with the Holy Spirit, tells us in 1 Corinthians 8:5 that there are Lords many and Gods many. We now know that each Lord must have a name and each God must have a name also. Elohim is a title, but unlike Lord and God, Elohim is a divine title. This means that Elohim is a title that our Creator chose for himself. Jesus is a name. Jesus is an erroneous name. A minor investigation on your part into a good dictionary or encyclopedia would prove that the Hebrew language, the Greek language, nor the Latin language have any characters or letters in their alphabet that would produce the sound that is made by this letter J. Neither was there a letter J in the English language until some 1400 years after the death of the Messiah. Therefore, such names as Jesus and Jehovah are impossible renderings for the true and original name of our Heavenly Father and His Son. Christ is a title, just like Lord and God. Yahweh is pure spirit, and in this state he's incomprehensible, inscrutable, and indiscernible. He is the ultimate source, substance, limits, and bounds of everything. We have Yahweh symbolized in his pure spirit state on this chart as a cloud. Yahweh is not a cloud. He merely chose a cloud to symbolize himself because a cloud has no particular or descriptive shape and form. Now we have drawn this cloud all around the edges of this chart to show you that everything on this chart is within the cloud. In like manner, everything in the universe abides within the pure spirit state of Yahweh. Yahweh, knowing that man could not perceive of him in this pure spirit state, took on shape and took on form right within himself as Elohim. This is the Word or Son, a super incorporeal being, that is, having the shape and form of a man, but without flesh and blood. Now, this shape and form can only be seen in a divine vision and understood in a divine revelation. Later on, the self-same spirit manifests himself in a physical body and walked the earth plane as Yahshua the Messiah. The world calls him Jesus Christ. Now, there's only one name given unto salvation, and we all must know this name. So the simple, yet intelligent question we should ask ourselves is, what was the name of the Savior during the time he walked the earth plain? A further understanding of his name and title could be had by reading the preface of the Holy Name Bible. Also in the school, we teach by the divine pattern of the universe. It is called the divine pattern because it is Yahweh's pattern. After Yahweh Elohim led the children of Israel out of the land of Egypt, he called Moses on top of Mount Sinai and showed him a tabernacle pattern in a vision. He instructed Moses to build one exactly like it in the wilderness of Sinai. Now this pattern consists of a most holy place, a holy place, and a court round about. These three compartments make up the one tabernacle pattern. And we go forth in the school to prove that everything in the universe operates according to the structure and function of this threefold tabernacle pattern, and that absolutely nothing escapes the pattern. Now the 10 primary constitutional objectives or aims of this institute are as follows. Number one is to help you find and know Yahweh or Elohim as he really is and actually exists. Two is to form a nucleus of universal brotherhood of humanity in Yahshua the Messiah, without distinction of race, nationality, creed, sex, caste, or color. Third is to investigate the unexplained spirit law, the so-called law of nature, and the powers latent in man. Fourth is to encourage and promote the study of the scriptures, comparative religions, psychology, philosophy, modern, practical, and occult science. Fifth is to extirpate current superstitions, skepticism, and ignorance. Sixth is to learn, know, and understand the operation of Yahweh's eternal purpose through the dispensations and ages. Seventh is to discern and avoid being deceived by Lucifer, the devil, the serpent, or Satan and his demons operating the mystery of iniquity on earth through the dispensation of time. And eighth is to earnestly contend for the common salvation of faith that was once delivered unto the sons or children of Yahweh. And ninth is to make known that Yahweh, from the beginning ordained, there is no other name given among men whereby man can be saved, save in the name of Yahshua the Messiah. And tenth is to inherit eternal life now in the kingdom of Yahshua the Messiah with the hope of immortal glorification in the new earth state. Our watchword is peace. Our slogan is speak the truth. Tonight we have a prayer by Dr. Christopher Williams. Our scripture lesson is Matthew, the fourth chapter. Our scripture reader will be Dr. Eunice Reiser. We have a selection of music after the prayer.
Good morning, class.
Good morning.
Let's bar our hearts and minds in a moment of prayer. Dear Heavenly Father Yahweh, we thank you once again for allowing us to assemble ourselves to learn more about your purpose, pattern, and plan. We thank you for the opportunity to continue one more day to eat off these plates that you've given us to learn more about Yahshua's coming and what he's done for us throughout the ages and dispensations. Please continue to give us the strength and the guidance to sojourn on this earth through all the things that are going on in our current situation, and to continue to bless those that are strong in the faith, and to bless those that have zero. All these blessings we ask through the only begotten Son, Yahshua Messiah. Let us all say,
Hallelujah.
Change.
Taught me how to change.
class.
Good morning.
The scripture lesson will be taken from Matthew, the 4th chapter, page 3 in the back of the book. And I'll be reading from the Holy Name Bible containing the Holy Name version of the Old and New Testament, critically compared with ancient authorities and various manuscripts revised by the late A.B. Turner. Matthew, the 4th chapter. Then was Joshua led up of the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted of the adversary. And after he had fasted 40 days and 40 nights, he was hungry. And then the tempter came to him and said, If thou be the Son of Yahweh, command that these stones be made bread. But he answered and said, It is written, Man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeded out of the mouth of Yahweh. Then the adversary taken him up into the holy city, and set him on a pinnacle of the temple, and said unto him, If thou be the Son of Yahweh, cast thyself down, for it is written, He shall give his angel charge concerning thee to guard thee in all thy ways. And in their hands they shall bear thee up, lest any time thou dash thy foot against a stone. Joshua said unto him, It is written again, Thou shalt not tempt Yahweh thy Elohim. Again, the adversary taketh him up into an exceeding high mountain, and showeth him all the kingdoms of the world, and the glory of them, and said unto him, All these things will I give thee, if thou wilt fall down and worship me. Then said Joshua unto him, Get thee hence, Satan, for it is written, Thou shalt worship Yahweh thy Elohim, and him only shalt thou serve. Then the adversary leaveth him, and behold, angels came and ministered unto him. Now when Joshua had heard that John was cast into prison, he departed into Galilee. And leaving Nazareth, he came and dwelt in Capernaum, which is upon the seacoast, in the borders of Zebulun and Naphtali, in fulfillment of that which was spoken by Isaiah the prophet, saying, The land of Zebulun and the land of Naphtali, by the way of the sea beyond Jordan, Galilee of the nations, the people which walketh in darkness have seen great light, and to them which dwelt in the regions of the shadow of death, light has shined upon them. For that time Joshua began to preach and to say, Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. And Joshua, walking by the sea of Galilee, saw two brethren, Simon called Peter, and Andrew his brother, casting a net into the sea, for they were fishers. And he said unto them, Follow me, and I will make you fishers of men. And they straightway left their net and followed him. And going on from thence, he saw two other brothers, James and the son of Zebedee, and John his brother, in a ship with Zebedee, their father, mending their nets, and he called them. And they immediately left the ship and their father and followed him. And Joshua went about all Galilee, teaching their synagogues and preaching the gospel of the kingdom, and healing all manners of sickness and all manner of diseases among those which were possessed with demons, and those which were lunatics, and those that were paralytic, and he healed them. And there followed him great multitudes of people from Galilee and from Decapolis, and from Jerusalem, and from Judea, and from beyond Jordan. I have read Matthew, the 4th chapter. Let us all say,
Hallelujah. Okay, once again, good morning, and good morning to everybody out there in YouTube land and Facebook land. Okay, this is Sunday morning, almost afternoon. When is our our series for the Mystery of Iniquity.
It starts in May, technically.
Okay, next month we'll be going into it. We've been doing a little bit of practice with it, you know, on our classes during the week. So anyway, this is going to be an open floor today. Anybody want to give up, give a testimony or a lecture, hold your hand up or come up forward. If not, I'll start picking. Okay. Alrighty, first speaker this morning would be Irene Ramirez.
That made it today. Everybody's feeling good and ready to get on with today's lectures. Anyway, let's see. We've been going over this mystery of iniquity, and I know it's starting and already has started. So let's go on and start right there with Yahshua the Messiah. After he had gotten baptized, we just read it. But let's read 3 and, is it 3 and 13?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
3 and 13, Matthew. Then cometh Yahshua from Galilee to Jordan unto John to be baptized of him. But John forbade him, saying, I have need to be baptized of thee, and comest thou to me? And Yahshua answered, saying unto him, permit it to be so now. For thus it becometh us to fulfill all righteousness.
Okay, you know, at that time, Yahshua, the children of Israel told that they had to be baptized. That was one of their laws that they were under these cardinal ordinances right here. It said right here, baptism, circumcision, ceremonies, Passovers, sacrifices, and the Ten Commandments. These were the cardinal ordinances that the Jews had to follow. So of course, Yahshua, when he comes in, he said also that he come into, let's get that 5 and 17 real quick of John, or Matthew. Is it Matthew?
Matthew.
Matthew, 5:17. Think not that I am come to destroy the law or the prophets. I am not come to destroy, but to fulfill.
Go ahead.
For verily I say unto you, till heaven and earth pass, one yod, or the smallest part of a letter, shall in no wise pass from the law till all be fulfilled.
Okay. So Yahshua, of course, he's fulfilling even right here. Everything they come in to do in the world, he says he coming to fulfill. That was his mission. That was his job. To bring these cardinal ordinances to an end. And he's right here, he's doing it. He's coming in to his ministry. So before he starts, he comes in, he's going to be baptized by John. Because it was prophesied that John would be the one to point him out. It says they're in the law. And when Yahshua comes in, well, for all Jews that come in, they were supposed to admit that they could not keep the law of Moses. So Yahshua, he comes in to John, and John's standing there saying, okay, he's waiting for the next person, and here comes Yahshua, and he comes in, and John says, okay, what are you supposed to say? In other words, that's what I got of it. And Yahshua says, I come here. What did he say again? This comes us to fulfill. There in Matthew. Matthew 3.
Okay. But John forbade him, saying, I have need to be baptized of thee, and comest thou to me?
Okay.
And Yahshua answering and said unto him, permit it to be so now. For thus it becometh us to fulfill all righteousness.
Okay, right there. There goes Yahshua. It says, go ahead and do it. I'm supposed to be here. I'm supposed to be baptized, and you're supposed to be one that do it. And he goes on, he does it, he gets baptized, Yahshua. Now after that, that's what we had read in our scripture lesson, that he comes and he comes out and he goes into the wilderness. And who comes along? The adversary. Mm-hmm. Trying to test him again. And he's here walking around, and the adversary is doing The adversary is doing what he's supposed to be doing. He's supposed to try to get everybody, and he thinks he can go to Yahshua and try to convince him that, you know, if I give you everything out in the earth plane, and Yahshua comes back at him right away and throws it at him and says, hey, what did you say? What does it say in there?
But you know, man shall not live by bread alone.
Okay, go ahead.
But by every word that proceeded out of the mouth of Yahweh.
Go ahead.
Then the adversary taking him up into a high, to a holy city, mm-hmm. and showed him a pinnacle of temple, mm-hmm. and said unto him, if thou be the son of Yahweh, cast thyself down, for it is written, he shall give his angels charge concerning thee to guard thee in all thy ways.
Okay. That was said, but not this angel. This angel could not have no kind of authority, no kind of ruling on, you know, Yahweh gave him a little bit of time to do that, yes. And he's still doing it. He's doing his job. But Yahshua could at that time come in and fulfill it and let him know, hey, you can't do this. You can't. And he says, you can't tempt Yahweh thy Elohim. Can you read that real quick?
Yahshua said unto him, it is written again, thou shalt not tempt Yahweh thy Elohim.
Go ahead.
Again, the adversary taking him up into an exceeding high mountain and showed him all the temple, the kingdoms of the world, mm-hmm. and the glory of them, and said unto him, these things will I give thee if thou wilt fall down and worship me.
And
then said Yahshua unto him, get thee hence, Satan, for it is written, thou shalt worship Yahweh thy Elohim, and him only shalt thou serve.
Okay. And that was one of Yahshua's missions, to come in to let us all know too, that we are only supposed to be worshiping Yahweh Elohim. And this is right here, this is the baptism and ministry plate right here, plate 29. We've been going over these, and I'm just showing right here what happened to the Messiah when he comes in. He is fulfilling. He goes to John, and then he's right here being trying to, the adversary is trying to tell him, you know, if you do this, that, give you that. Just like, I mean, in our world right here, right now, we are not keeping these laws of being baptized. We are being baptized by the Holy Spirit. It is said under Yahshua says that he is the comforter, mm-hmm. and he's supposed to baptize us in the name, you know, and which we know the name is Yahshua, and with the Holy Spirit, which is the comforter, which is Yahshua. So we come to learn that. And that's why we go over these charts. Now, I'm going to sit down right now because I want somebody else to go into deeper in that. I'm just laying that little foundation. And I thank you very much.
Hallelujah.
Alrighty, thank you for that. Next testimony, actually, you're going to be from we have our president, class president here from the Brand School, Dr. Christopher Williams.
Straighten the strap, flatten it out.
Oh, this one? Is it right? Mm-hmm. Got it? All right, cool. so I do appreciate the first speaker that talks about Yahshua and his mission, because the whole purpose of what's coming here is to learn more about Yahshua's purpose, pattern, and plan.
Right.
And what we've come to know is that everything that we that exists and that we don't know exists, it's following a pattern that's in operation. Universal Spirit Law, or Yahweh, is running the show. And that nothing that we do is done haphazardly, but it's all according to a purpose and a pattern that we're all following. And no matter what we think we're doing, no matter what we think we're not following some plan, there is a plan in operation. And the great thing about Yahweh is that, well, he's consistent. Isaiah 46, 9 and 10.
Remember the former things of old.
Mm-hmm.
For I am El, and there is none else.
So remember the former things of old. The I am El, and there is none else. So all he's saying is, there ain't nothing but me in operation. Okay? Read.
I am Elohim, and there is none like me.
So when Yahshua came onto the scene, that wasn't God's little boy. That was Yahweh himself in the shape and form of a man in the likeness of sinful flesh running the show. Read. Because keep in mind, there is no one like him.
Right.
He said it in Isaiah, and then he declared it and just became that which he said. Right? Read.
Declaring the end from the beginning.
Now, I don't know anything about anyone on this earth, past or present, save Yahshua Messiah, that can declare the beginning, the end from the beginning. I've never seen it. Read.
And from ancient times, the things are not yet done, saying, my counsel shall stand, and I will do all my pleasure.
Now, when Yahweh spoke this creation into existence, it did just that. It existed according to his pattern, and because of his will, it existed. And it continues to exist until he's ready to take this thing out.
Right.
Now, the great thing about Yahweh is that whatever he set up in the realm of eternity has done nothing but continue on and continue on and continue on. And the way that he operates is that you can see him and recognize him according to his pattern so that you know that it's true and correct. So the best way to identify Yahshua is, one, he's real consistent about his message. So we read it, but we want to read it again. So Matthew 5:17, read.
Matthew 5:17. Think not that I have come to destroy the law or the prophets.
Mm-hmm.
I have not come to destroy, but to fulfill.
So Yahweh is here to fulfill.
Right.
But just in case you didn't get the message, mm-hmm. 3 and 13.
Matthew 3 and 13. Then cometh Yahshua from Galilee to Jordan unto John to be baptized of him. And John forbade it, saying, I have need to be baptized of thee,
mm-hmm.
and thou comest to me?
Mm-hmm.
And Yahshua answering said unto him,
mm-hmm.
Permit it to be so now, for thus it becometh us to fulfill our righteousness.
Now, whenever he was talking to someone, they would ask him, sire, what are you doing? I'm fulfilling.
Mm-hmm.
That's all he kept saying. It's almost as if they didn't hear him the first time he said it.
Right.
But he just kept repeating himself and repeating himself, and he did just that. Everything he did on this earth was to fulfill. So it becomes our job to identify those things that he's done to fulfill the scriptures like he said he did. Because he said, I didn't come to destroy them.
Right.
He came to fulfill them. Now, there are a group of people, a lot of them, who will lead you to believe that he came to establish a Christian way of life or set an example for us or WWJD, what would Jesus do? You know, all these things that don't really matter. But that is not what Yahshua's mission was.
Right.
He was very clear and very concise. In fact, his grammar or his English is really good. He said, I've come to fulfill.
Right.
So he didn't do anything but that. And the way he did it is by performing that which you see from Genesis down to Malachi.
Right.
Because there ain't nothing to it but to do it, as far as I'm concerned, right?
Mm-hmm.
Now, people say a lot of things, but it doesn't matter until you do these things. You know, I could tell you, I could tell a woman I love her to get where I want to get to, but eventually I gotta put my money where my mouth is, right? Because if you don't, then she gonna quit me, right? We don't want that, so you got to at least do something or show how you're going to fulfill those words that you express, right? So Yahweh is no different, right? So he says he's come to fulfill, and so we gotta see how is Joshua fulfilling the scriptures the way he said he did.
Right.
Now, there's a multiplicity of examples of how Joshua is fulfilling, but we'll take a few examples and then go from there. Now, let's see, where am I at? Now, we had John and Joshua here at the Jordan River, and he is here fulfilling water baptism. Okay? Now, we need to see, one, where did Joshua establish or first baptize in water? So we need to go back to Moses, right? That's what he says. So just so I don't want to just make this stuff up. John 5:39.
Okay, here we go. John 5:39.
Mm-hmm. Okay, I got it. Ye search the scriptures, for in them ye think ye have eternal life.
Read.
And they are they which testify of me.
Now, who's speaking right now? This is Joshua Messiah talking about ye search the scriptures. For in them ye think ye have eternal life, but they are they which testify of me. So he's talking to the scribes and Pharisees and letting them know that I know you guys have been reading these scriptures and everything, but they're not talking about you.
Right.
They're not an example for you to follow. Mm-hmm. It's just right. Me telling you about me.
Right.
But read.
But ye will not come to me that ye might have life.
Read.
I receive not honor from men.
Now, he said, I don't receive any honor from men because he, one, he doesn't need a man to honor him. He's that which people are trying to do, right? So he's all the honor that he needs. He is a self-existing deity. And he said, remember the former things of old, because I am El and there is none else.
Right.
So he don't need anyone's honor.
Right.
Make sense? Mm-hmm. Read.
But I know you, that ye have not the love of Elohim in you.
Because the outpouring of the Holy Spirit had not even occurred yet.
Right.
He's like, he's walking around with the secret that nobody knows, and they think they're in the know. They had no clue that they weren't even worthy of being in the same vicinity of him.
Yeah.
But he's working a work because he was the sacrificial lamb.
Right.
Who was slain at the foundation of the world, right? Mm-hmm. Now, when you understand this thing, the purpose, you understand that when Yahweh came from behind the veil of inscrutability and presented himself as Yahweh Elohim, that was a death.
Right.
That was a divestation of this state and condition and to a lesser state, taking on a shape and form in a super corporeal body, thus being the creation. That was the foundation of the world right here, the death at the foundation of the world. But to fulfill that, he came in as Yahshua the Messiah to die the death of an outcast dog for all of us who were alive and who weren't even here yet. Because that is how we're going to understand and receive the gifts of the Holy Spirit through his blood and through his sacrifice. Read.
I am come in my Father's name, and you receive me not.
Read.
Let another come in his own name, him ye will receive.
Read.
How can ye believe which receive honor one of another, and seek it not the honor that come from Elohim only?
That always puzzles me. I mean, it just puzzles me how we have all these theologians and people that are just talking about God this, God that, the Word of God. Do you realize every TV evangelist are millionaires, multimillionaires, and that their constituents or their followers are broke? Not, as the youth says, they're broke, right? And it
it's to the point where they're telling you, keep praising God, praise God, this and that, and the other, but give me money so I can continue preaching the word of God. And yet we will get you to the promised land.
Yeah.
I'm going to live fat on the earth, but I'm giving you your salvation. That's what they're doing.
Yeah.
Makes sense out of that. But Yahshua's saying, y'all can't even follow you guys can't even honor each other in the right way. I mean, you seek the honor of these people, but not give the honor to Yahweh himself.
Right.
Mm-hmm. All right, read.
Do not think that I will accuse you to the Father.
Uh-huh.
There is one that accuses you,
mm-hmm.
even Moses,
uh-huh.
in whom you trust.
Now, they trust Moses because Moses to them was like George Washington to America, right? He was a big deal. He was their patriarch. He was the man. I mean, there's Yahweh and there's Moses. That's how that was the pecking order as far as they were concerned, because he was the one that started it off. So he's saying, don't even think that I'll accuse you to the Father. He's saying Moses is the one that's going to accuse you, because he's saying that Moses did what? Read.
For had ye believed Moses,
uh-huh.
ye would have believed me.
Right.
For he wrote of me.
Uh-huh. Now, at this point, they are marveling, like, you ain't even 40 yet. He's talking about he wrote of me.
Yeah, right.
But remember in the beginning, he says, ye search the scriptures, for in them you
right.
think ye have eternal life,
mm-hmm.
but they're really just talking about me.
Right.
So we need to see how Yahshua the Messiah was present and accounted for
right.
back here in the scriptures.
Mm-hmm.
Now, the thing that Yahweh does is he hides in plain sight. And the way he does that is he puts a veil up over you, over your eyes, so that you can't see what's really in front of you.
Mm-hmm.
Like, you didn't know that you were exactly what you've been looking for this entire time. You don't need
right.
to go outside of yourself to find Yahweh.
Mm-hmm.
He's there, present and accounted for.
Mm-hmm.
But because he wants you to go through some things, he wants to qualify you. Get you ready, arm you with to the T, so that when it's ready to go out and do the fighting, you ain't falling to no mealy-mouth person. You're not falling to some unworthy foe.
Mm-hmm.
You can take on the all challengers.
Right.
That's the beautiful thing about this gospel. And when you truly understand what the heck we're talking about down here, there is no one on the planet that can confound you or intimidate you with their knowledge of
right.
the Bible,
right.
because you have something more,
right.
more powerful than just a bunch of words and some quick wit. You have an actual pattern to follow. You have some credibility.
Mm-hmm.
So when you hear people that are not talking according to the scriptures, can't prove anything they say, you know exactly what time it is with these
right.
people.
Right.
I met a number of people in my journey that will talk about God this, God that, and you ask them one fundamental question and they crumble like a deck of cards. I mean, it is just terrible. Some of the things that you can ask someone. I mean, you ask them what spirit is, and they just get into a tizzy. I mean, I've seen some people just lose. I once lost a friend because I asked them what spirit was. In fact, the girl was so mad at me because she was a big giant Christian. I mean, devout Christian, Christianity this, Christianity that. And I just say, hey, just out of curiosity, what is spirit? And she says, well, spirit's God. Okay. That's fair enough. What is God? Well, it's spirit. Well, when he said Yahweh is spirit, and those that worship me in spirit and in truth, what does that mean? I don't understand why you're trying to trip me up here. And we went around and around for about 5 minutes to the point where she said, you know what, just don't talk to me ever again. It's a Christian. Christian, yeah. Turn the other cheek, love thy neighbor, the whole nine yards, right? She didn't want to love me anymore. She was like, she couldn't stand me. In fact, she let her own quit. Good times. I mean, it was funny. However, the point is, we need to see Yahshua back here in the scriptures.
Right.
Now, you can get me 3:13 so we can identify and qualify Moses meeting Yahweh, but we're going to get to it as soon as possible. Because we want to show how, one, the Messiah was baptized back here in the Jordan, and we want to see how he was baptized in the scriptures.
Mm-hmm.
Read. I'm sorry, I didn't even give you scripture.
Exodus 3:13.
We're going to cut it up. We don't need to go through the whole minutia.
Exodus 3:13.
Uh-huh.
And Moses said unto Elohim,
uh-huh,
behold, when I come unto the children of Israel, and shall say unto them,
uh-huh,
the Elohim of your fathers has sent me unto you,
uh-huh,
and they shall say to me, what is his name?
Now
what shall I say unto them?
Now, we read earlier in John how he says, ye search the scriptures, for they are they who testify to me. Then he says, I come in my Father's name, and you receive me not.
Mm-hmm.
Let another come in his own name, him you will receive. Now, Jesus Christ, everyone receives them. Allah, Buddha, any name that you can think of that's world-renowned, they receive it. In fact, people know that Yahweh is the true name of the Heavenly Father, but yet...
Right.
There is no church talking about Yahweh in his purpose. That's just not what they do.
Right.
So we got Moses down here at the burning bush learning about the name of Yahweh from the beginning of this whole thing that we call the scriptures, right? Because this is where the Bible actually begins. This is where the story begins so that we can understand and know who Yahweh is as he really is and actually exists. So you have Yahweh appearing to Moses in a burning bush, mm-hmm, professing the name of Yahweh.
Mm-hmm.
Now, because Moses came from a place where everything was a god, he said, hey, just common sense. What is your name?
Yeah.
Because I need to be able to say, well, this God,
mm-hmm,
by the name of this name, has come and sent me to deliver you out of the hands of Egypt.
Right.
Because locusts was a god, frogs was a god, the sun was a god, but every god had a name, right? So he says what? Read.
And Elohim, what shall I say unto them?
Mm-hmm.
And Elohim said unto Moses, Eya Asher Eya.
Read.
And he said, thus shalt thou say unto the children of Israel.
So he first says, Eya Asher Eya, I will be what I will to be. So he's qualifying what his ability is.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, when you hear that statement, it doesn't, at first it didn't sound like much, but when you think about what that means, I will be what I will to be. In today's world, we call that speaking your destiny into existence, right?
Mm-hmm.
We're gonna say, I will be a millionaire one day, and then thus it's going to manifest itself. Yahweh saying, I will be the creation, and thus it was. I will be Ignacio Ramirez, and thus I am. I will be a camera for will to use, and thus we are projecting. Do you understand what I'm talking about? This is an unlimited statement,
right,
of limitless,
right,
possibilities.
Mm-hmm.
Now, Christian translation will say, I am that I am. Now, if you ever watched the cartoon Popeye the Sailor Man, all he was a sailor man.
Mm-hmm.
And that's all he ever wanted to be. It's a very limited statement, powerless statement when you think about it. Well, it's kind of like, it is what it is. Well, what is it?
Yeah.
Right? So here we have an unlimited statement being given first, a phrase to explain who Yahweh really is. And then he says what? Read.
I will be has sent me unto you.
Read.
And Elohim said, moreover unto Moses, thus shalt thou say unto the children of Israel,
uh-huh,
Yahweh the Elohim of your fathers,
uh-huh,
the Elohim of Abraham,
mm-hmm,
the Elohim of Isaac, and the Elohim of Jacob,
uh-huh,
has sent me unto you.
So he declared the name Yahweh.
Right.
He who brings into existence whatever exists, right? And his phrase is, Eya Asher Eya, I will be what I will to be.
Right.
Because later on, he's going to qualify, he's going to prove that statement, that phrase, by saying, cast that rod into the, on the ground.
Right.
And it turns into a serpent. And then he's going to say, hey, pick that serpent by the tail, which you never do, because he's just asking it big. And it turns right back into a rod,
mm-hmm,
saying, I will be a serpent on the ground or a rod in your hand. Or a staff in your hand, right?
Mm-hmm.
So he's qualifying him or proving his existence.
Mm-hmm.
Now, he doesn't need to do all that.
Mm-hmm.
But because these are tools for greater good, he's doing what he needs to do for a purpose,
right?
Mm-hmm. Because remember, Yahweh doesn't do anything haphazardly. Everything is going according to a purpose.
Right.
And a pattern, and a plan. Now, if anyone's ever built anything, worked in an operation, or created something from scratch, nothing is done correctly haphazardly. If you work in construction, there are some plans that you got to follow, right?
That's right.
If you work for an operation where there's processes and people that have to function, someone has to sit down, think about how to plan this out, figure out how many people it's going to take to do this plan, and then how is it going to be executed and have people in place to make sure it runs swell so that if you're not there, it's going to run properly. That is happening in real life,
right,
with just everyday people. You really think that Yahweh is going to work without a plan? The creator of heaven and earth just, you know what? Let's see if it works. Does that sound intelligent to you?
No.
Because a creator that is the source and substance of intelligence, wisdom, and knowledge, beauty, love, and justice, foundation, power, and strength, is going to have a plan in operation. He's going to have some thought that's going to come. This is divine intelligence. Not like just some everyday average intelligence, like E equals MC squared intelligence. It is surpass that kind of intelligence.
Right.
The source and substance of that E equals MC squared,
right,
is planning this out.
That's right. Mm-hmm.
So when he says, hey, put that rod on the ground, it was to show Moses that, hey, you're not going down there by yourself.
Right.
You have an actual power work with you that's going to take care of you. So you may be speaking for me, but I'm actually running the show.
Right.
That's why he did it. And that's the power. That's the beautiful thing about this gospel. Because some people kind of lose sight and lose faith of the fact that there is something guiding us throughout our lives. And the best way to identify Yahshua, the Messiah, in operation is to see the same stories that are occurring in the Bible that are actually being fulfilled through your life. Mm. The manifestation of these principles are always laid down in our lives. That's why we come here. We don't come here just for so we can feel good at the end of the day. We come here to qualify what we already knew, that Yahweh's got us, right? Mm. So when we walk on this earth,
right,
we should always be focused on the pattern that is in operation. Because you're always somewhere on the steps of this pattern, right? And Yahshua was fulfilling this pattern within you each and every day. And sometimes you spend a lot of time down here, okay? You don't have your time on this altar. We're all being sacrificed on a daily basis. But if you don't ever reach here, it's because there's something that you haven't learned down here. Does that make sense? And I'm not just saying this because I'm just making this stuff up. I have lived this every day as long as I can imagine. We all had our day in the sun of being down here, and we also had our day in the sun being here. This is a circle, the cycle that happens all the time. Because what happens on the Day of Atonement? Mm-hmm. That high priest comes up,
right,
sprinkles that blood, does that figure eight, and he does it again, and he does it again. And every year, the Day of Atonement, he does that figure eight over and over and over to say that, hey, your life is a repetition of a pattern that's in operation that's happening over and over and over again. Because guess what? You shouldn't be faltering because there's a pandemic.
Yeah.
You shouldn't be worried because we got a bumbling idiot in office. You shouldn't be worried that your boss don't know his behind from a hole in the wall. You should not worry that your kids sometimes make some stupid decisions. You shouldn't be faltering because, you know what, sometimes it's just not going your way. Your salvation is either coming or is. You just don't see it yet.
Right.
And if you're waiting for your salvation till you die, that means you think heaven is some destination off in the far and by and by, which is not. Heaven is a state of consciousness. That if you understand what Yahshua was talking about when he's here, and that dose descends, hey, this is my beloved son in whom I'm well pleased, hear ye him. That was heaven made manifest with Yahshua the Messiah. When the outpouring of the Holy Spirit was given to those Israelites, thus making them recipients of a gift that they did not earn, that was heaven on earth. And if you were present at San Antonio Hospital, May 17, 2019, you saw a man take off the flesh and had no fear in his eyes. That was heaven on earth, made manifest for anyone that was there. That's Yahweh in operation. But we're trying to talk about, we're trying to get to a destination, right? I want to get there so I can sit down. Anyhow, so we're talking about that name. So he qualified his name. He gave him some things to let him know that he's not going up to Egypt by himself, right? Now, Yahweh's going to unleash 10 devastating plagues on these people down here. The first three plagues was for everybody. Because he wanted these Israelites to know, you're not dealing with no punk. What he wants you to understand is, I am Yahweh, and you're going to do what the heck I said. So he needs to qualify and get their attention. Let them know that at any given moment, I don't need you. So they had to suffer a little bit. Now, notice there's 10 devastating plagues. How many attributes did Yahweh use for his principal attributes? 10, right? You got the 9 major attributes wrapped in the kingdom, right? He's got this repetition thing down pat. You see it in just about everything he does, right? So here, he's laying out 10 devastating plagues, three for the Egyptians and the Israelites, and then that last 7 was strictly for the Egyptians, right? So he's going to just overthrow Pharaoh and his hosts. So when they come out, I believe it's what, the 29th chapter of Exodus? Was it 20? Yeah.
What is it you want? After the Passover.
It's after Passover when they're at
the Red Sea.
At the Red Sea.
Oh, you want the Red Sea?
Yeah, 29th chapter, right?
No, it's a 14.
Oh, yeah, you're right. I'm sorry. I'm tripping. I apologize.
I'll start at 12.
Thank you.
It is not this the word that we did make tell thee in Egypt, saying, let us alone, that we may serve the Egyptians? Mm-hmm. For it had been better for us to serve the Egyptians than we should die out in the wilderness.
Now, after the plague of death and the Passover, mm-hmm. Pharaoh said, go on, get out. Just take whatever you want. Just leave. You're killing me. Literally killing me. And they're at the Red Sea, and all of a sudden, Yahweh said, no, I need to make sure these people realize what time it is. So he hardens Pharaoh's heart, and the Egyptians are hot in pursuit.
Right. Mm-hmm.
Now, these Israelites come to the Red Sea. They got the Red Sea in front of them, mounds on each side of them, and you got the Egyptians hot on their trail, ready to take them out. And they're coming here and they're saying, what the heck did you bring us out here for? To die at the Red Sea in this desert? Are you kidding? We would have been better off being enslaved with the Egyptians. At least we'd be alive. And so they're losing faith, right? Because that's what we do.
Right.
We lose faith. We get weak. Mm-hmm. Human condition, what are you going to do? But yet, Moses says what?
And Moses said unto the people, fear ye not, stand still and see the salvation of Yahweh, which he will show to you today. For the Egyptians whom ye see today, ye will see again no more forever. Mm-hmm. Yahweh shall fight for you, mm-hmm. and ye shall hold your peace. Mm-hmm. And Yahweh said unto Moses, therefore criest thou unto me?
Now, when she reads it, it reads like Moses saying, hey, stand still, see the salvation of Yahweh. But standing next to him was Joshua the son of Nun.
Right.
And he said, hey, stand still, see the salvation of Yahweh. Now, correct me if I'm wrong, but this name has a meaning, right?
Right.
It means Yahweh is salvation.
Right.
So, when he's speaking, he's saying, stand still, see Yahshua. Mm-hmm. And he's standing right there. Mm-hmm. And Yahshua said, are you crazy or something? This is not the plan. Okay. You messing this up. Hold up the rod, sucker. And when he does that, the tunnel, the waters tunnel over, and they go on through dry land. Mm-hmm. Now he tells them that for a reason. Now they followed that cloud that led them through the dividing waters of the Red Sea, but that was Joshua present and accounted for at the Red Sea, and they said, "Stand still, see Joshua,
right,
or Yahweh is salvation." Now doesn't that kind of sound like Joshua at the Jordan River?
Mm-hmm.
So here you have Joshua baptized, or initially baptizing the Israelites, all of them, at the Red Sea.
Mm-hmm.
Now, when he got baptized here at the Jordan River, that was the baptism for everybody, right, was it not?
Right.
Call me crazy. That sounds like a doggone fulfillment.
Mm-hmm.
Like I said, he doesn't do anything haphazardly. So Yahweh is so quick, so clever, so smooth. Just in everything he does is falling according to a pattern that this happens back here with the Israelites to initiate or establish that covenant,
right,
mm-hmm,
or establish water baptism, and then he goes on and fulfills it. And just so we have clarification, please, someone get me 1 Corinthians 10 and 1.
Okay, I have it. 1 Corinthians 10 and 1.
Moreover, brethren, that means on top of what I already told you, read.
I will not that you should be ignorant.
Don't be ignorant of this fact.
Right.
Meaning, don't be stupid now. They already told you this, but I'm going to reiterate what I already said. Read.
How that all our fathers were under the cloud and all passed through the sea.
All of the Egyptians were under the cloud and under the sea. Read.
And all were baptized unto Moses in the cloud and in the sea.
They were baptized back here unto Moses in the cloud and in the sea. Read.
And did all eat the same spiritual food.
Read.
And did all drink the same spiritual drink.
Read on.
For they drank of that spiritual rock that went with them.
Uh-huh.
And the rock was the Messiah.
Say that one more time.
For they drank of that spiritual rock,
uh-huh,
that went with them.
Read.
And that rock was the Messiah.
It's like I just made that up, right? I mean, I literally can't make this up. So not only do we show, according to the scriptures, how that Joshua Messiah was back there. Moses said, my mom went to a church called Mount Gilead Baptist Church. When my mom and my dad first hooked up, she was going to this church, right? And at this church, it was a very, very prominent, very well-known pastor named Pastor Johnson. Really nice man. I love the man. He was a sweet guy. And my dad used to always challenge Pastor Johnson. Now, if you ever met Pastor Johnson, he was a very modest, very meek individual. And here comes Joe Williams, young and dumb, challenging anyone and everybody because he's so bold. Because he was going to class in L.A. with his father, and he wants to go and challenge the pastor at Mount Gilead Baptist Church. Now, at the time back then, this was when it was the height of this church. They had hundreds of people in this congregation. And here comes my mom's boyfriend talking crap to the daggone pastor, says, "Hey, can you show me Jesus in the Old Testament?" He says, "If you show me Jesus, I'll pay every bill you got in this place. But if not, you need to shut down." Now, Pastor Johnson looked at him like he was crazy, because Pastor Johnson knew you will not find Jesus nowhere in the Old Testament. And so he says, "What if I shows you the Messiah back there with Moses?" Because he knew about Joshua is Joshua. And so he showed him this, and at this point, Pastor Johnson said, "Don't come back no more." He wouldn't let him come back. In fact, my mom would never let him go to church again because he embarrassed the heck out of her. Because he was like, "Who are you bringing this jive turkey to my dang on church? Embarrassing me in front of my congregation." Because that's how Joe Williams was. Gotta love him. But you are not going to find Jesus nowhere in the Old Testament. In fact, we would tell you, we'll shut this whole place down if you do. And to this day, we're still in existence because you will not see Jesus in the Old Testament, because it didn't exist. Because Jesus has no power. There is nothing to that name.
Right.
Now, Yahshua, you will. And we just proved it according to scriptures. And not only that, we showed how Yahshua the Messiah was fulfilling that which he established.
Right.
And how all the Egyptians were baptized in the cloud and in the sea. Thus, proving the existence of Yahshua the Messiah. That's the beauty of this gospel. And that's why we come here. Mm-hmm. We don't come here for anything else other than that. Because if you're coming for anything other than that, you are not that of Yahshua Messiah, but that of this bad boy right here. The mystery of iniquity.
Right.
Now, when we talk about the mystery of iniquity, I don't want you to make this, please make no mistake about this. This is not somebody that's just pure evil. He is doing that which he was set up to do. This is his job.
Right.
His job is to confound the so-called in the know people. That is his job, to trip you up and make you be confused about that which you know.
Right.
He wants you to think that it's all about him or the human condition, but really and truly it's about Yahshua and righteousness. I'll give you an example of what I'm talking about. Let's just take what we have going on right now. We have this pandemic that is ruining the world. I can't even get a bite to eat at a restaurant because this pandemic has ruined it, right? You have no idea. I'm dying without breakfast. Anyhow, the government decided they're going to help out small businesses because they imposed, and listen, the government leveraged a lot of things on small businesses because small businesses are keeping this country afloat. If you think that Walmart, Amazon, and Apple are actually keeping this business, this country going, it's not really them. It is the small businesses that are attached to them that is keeping this country afloat.
Mm-hmm.
And so the government recognizes that, so they leveraged the small business owner and said, hey, you all are going to have to pay for these people to be off of work because they're not going. Right? But we'll give you some relief, and we're going to give you a loan to help you along the way. Now, people that really needed the loan, applied for the loan, did their due diligence, did everything they're supposed to, got a loan. But then, these people who saw an opportunity to get money, called large corporations, did the same thing. And they claimed they were doing it for the greater good because they too have employees that they want to make sure they can pay. And really and truly, all they did was line their pockets. Millions of dollars were given out to these people. Now, you saw the difference between a righteous move and an unrighteous move. Now, they both had the same intentions, but one was to execute for the greater good, and one was to execute for their own selfish reasons. That is the difference between Yahshua and Satan. And that's what we are here to do, recognize the difference between righteousness and unrighteousness.
Right.
And the only way you're going to see righteousness is through the pattern that has been laid out for us through the preaching of the gospel of the Holy Spirit, right? But if you do not, and you are not capable of recognizing that pattern operation, you are following that of Satan, thus being tripped up and confused.
Right.
That is the beautiful thing about this gospel. There is always redemption, right? Smack dab in your face. All you got to do is open your eyes. And because Yahweh is so good at what he does, he hides right in front of you until, boom, to the appointed time and the right time to show you exactly where you are on that pattern and recognize that, hey, he's running the show, not you.
Right.
So when you come down here to these classes and you sit in these seats, you are not here recognizing the man or the person on the floor speaking, but the Holy Spirit that's speaking through them. And if they're not speaking according to the scriptures and by this pattern, you need to just tell him, or as Kendall would say, prove it! Because they're not speaking that which of Yahweh. They're talking about malarkey.
And that's not what we're here for. So I do hope and trust you got something that was said today, and I appreciate the opportunity. It's been a long time. But I wanted to make sure I didn't infect anyone because, you know, my ex-wife, I was in her vicinity, but we're good to go. Everyone's back in order because Yahweh is continuing to bless us. And all praises and honor be to Yahshua Messiah. Thank you. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. All righty. Okay, we have much time? Oh, yeah. Next speaker will be Dr. Will Williams.
Good afternoon, class.
Good afternoon.
It is indeed an honor and a pleasure to be here, considering the conditions, to learn and more about this purpose and plan of our Heavenly Father, Yahweh Elohim, and according to a divine purpose. And I appreciate the first two speakers on what they had to say, and particularly the previous one, what he said about his father. I thought that was humorous. And it also reminded me of some stuff. I kind of did something similar, you know. There were other folks in class that, back in the day, we were a lot more bolder and younger, right? Like, for example, I can think of Rip Macklin, for example. He used to do that. He would join a church. He'd be in the congregation. And then 30 days later, he'd be sitting up there in the assistant pastor spot in that church. But he's trying to preach the gospel to them, that kind of thing. And you have the power to do that kind of stuff. I don't know if you really would want to. Me, myself. I did it myself once with a friend of mine when I lived in Texas. He joined a church Bible group. And it was a Bible group that was part of a church that was very, very prominent in the Fort Worth, Dallas area by a very prominent preacher who was well known in the area. He was also a civil rights activist and all. And I don't know why this guy wanted to do it, but I didn't want him to do it by himself, so I went with him just for the two of us. At least I said, well, if he gets jumped on, at least I'll be there to help back him up, and we'll get jumped on together. But somehow, we made it for a whole year in that class. We didn't start off like Joe Williams. We just did it gradually. Honestly, we did it gradually. We didn't even use the names for like maybe a month or so, but then we gradually worked it in. And I don't know how, and I look back on it, and we were in this Christian Bible group, me and this other guy, he was Randolph Norris, and we were in this Bible group for a year, and as a matter of fact, we got recognized by the church. They had a special affair, and we went there, and we got recognized by the church for our good efforts, if you can believe that. I even met the guy. The guy now is a congressman from Missouri, from Kansas City. I can't think of his name. Oh, he's a black guy. Yeah, you've seen him on TV, but I met the guy at this church when he was the mayor of Kansas City. But he's a congressman now, and I met this guy, shook hands with him and everything, and he was like, yeah, I heard about what you guys did here, you know, all this kind of, I'm like, and it was just so surreal. And I was like, what am I doing here? You know? But, and after all of that, you know, after all of that, we only got, because we started a class in Arlington, Texas, and Randolph was the representative of it. And out of all of that effort,
Emmanuel Cleaver,
that's his name. He's a congressman, right? Mm-hmm. I met that guy. He wasn't a congressman then, he was the mayor of Kansas City, but he's a preacher. Mm-hmm. He's a preacher as well. I met this guy. shook hands with him at this church in outside of Dallas, Texas. And like I said, it was crazy. But out of all of that, we only got one person that came out of that. Just one person that came out of that church, who was a member of that church, that came out and started coming to our class. So I suppose it was worth it in that sense, all right? Paul used to do stuff like that, you know, when you read about it. You know, like Paul, for example, Dr. Kinley said this once in a transcript, and I don't know why some people don't like transcripts, you know, because I guess maybe because what Dr. Kinley preaches goes against, doesn't jive with what they're saying, which is why they tell you don't read them. Or they'll come to you and say, well, I need to interpret, you know, what you're reading. That kind of stuff. What's that scripture? I think Timothy says all scripture.
Oh, given. 2 Timothy.
2 Timothy 3:16, is it?
Yeah.
Let's read that right quick.
Second Timothy 3:16.
Uh-huh.
All the scriptures that is given by the inspiration of Yahweh.
Now listen, it says all the scripture that's given by the inspiration of Yahweh. Well, let me ask you a question. When Dr. Kinley was standing up here on the floor in the flesh and he's preaching and they made those audio recordings and they made transcriptions of them, one simple question, was he speaking by the inspiration of Yahweh?
Yes.
Yes or no?
Yes.
If the answer is yes, then you shouldn't have a problem with the transcripts or the pamphlets or the textbooks or the audios. You know, you want to know why? Read.
All the scriptures that is written by the inspiration of Yahweh is profitable for doctrine.
The transcripts, the textbook, the pamphlets, the audios, they are profitable. For what?
For doctrine.
For doctrine.
For reproof.
For reproof. You know what reproof means? Means to rebuke. So if I rebuke you with a transcript and you don't like it, I already know what you are.
Right.
You're a bastard.
Mm-hmm.
Plain and simple. Or a pamphlet or an audio, if it's truly by the inspiration of Yahweh. Now, I'm not saying believe it often, because Dr. Kinley, when he speaks, he shows his proof for what he's showing up here. Read.
For corruption, correction.
Thank you. Not for corruption. We ain't going for that.
Correction.
Though some people do use it for corruption. For correction, read.
For instruction in righteousness.
We've been using it for all along. For instruction in righteousness. So that what?
That the man of Yahweh may be perfect. Thoroughly furnished unto all good works.
The main mission of this class, according to our founder, is to raise up able-bodied ministers. That's the whole purpose of this. And to do this, we have these charts illustrated. Now, and there's another thing I got to jump on, because people are coming to me with, well, it don't matter about these correlations and stuff. Well, let me read you something what Dr. Kinley said about that. All right, you know. And it's from a transcript, so I know you ain't gonna like it. And the transcript is called Yahweh Elohim is the First Adam. Why don't y'all get that right quick? We're not gonna read the whole thing, though, you know, I wouldn't mind doing this as a class. And that's another thing. Some people objected to us reading the transcripts. Oh, no, they must think he's Dr. Kinley, because he's reading Dr. Kinley lines or something like, you know. Haven't y'all ever done a play? You know something? That play that they did, Kinley Got His Man, it would have been better off. And the money better spent if they had just duplicated one of Dr. Kinley's lectures. Have somebody play Dr. Kinley doing a lecture. You had the dialogue. We got lectures. Mm-hmm. That would have been better spent for that instead of that, you know, gotten. Oh, my God. Don't get me started on that. Do you have the transcript?
No, not yet. What's it called
again? Yahweh Elohim is the first Adam. I just want to read a few lines from it, and then we'll press on.
Okay, we have it. I have it.
Do you have it?
Yes.
All right. Just start with start at the beginning and start with Dr. Kinley.
Okay.
And read aloud so we can hear you.
Thank you ever so much.
This is the founder speaking. Read.
I just want to say that I hope that you got us something out there.
No, come
out
on
of that.
Now.
I'm sorry. You got something out of that. one thing we do try to do down here. We don't just try, we just go ahead and do it.
We just go ahead and do it, because we have these charts up here that we use, and this is the reason why. Keep reading.
And that is, we point out everything by the scriptures, and that removed to remove all doubt. Now just reading the Bible, I'm back again to that. Just reading the Bible, that don't mean you know anything about it.
Now see, now, the reason why he said that, you know, I don't care what you do. You can, okay. The reason why he said that is because Christians that was brought out by the previous speaker, they believe in the Bible too, and they say, well, why do you believe it? Well, I believe it because I believe it. You know, like if Noah, if it says that Moses and Israel crossed the Red Sea, well, I believe it because the Bible said so. But how could you prove it? You as a Christian, how could you prove that? You can't.
Right.
You just say, I believe it because I believe because the Bible said so. But here's what Dr. Kelly's trying to say. Read.
I'll tell you just like, now listen at what I'm going to say to you.
Mm-hmm.
Now what you have to do, and that what Brother Freddie has done.
Mm-hmm.
You have to make these correlations.
You have to make these correlations. You have to make that. Why, Reed?
Now, if you don't make these correlations, there's nothing you can do about it.
Now, if you don't make the correlation, there's nothing you can do about it. Do about what? Mm-hmm. Your ignorance.
Right.
There's nothing you can do about it. You'd be like them Christians. Well, why do you believe Moses and Israelites crossed the Red Sea? I believe because the Bible said so. Well, the Bible says I believe it. How could you prove it? Well, I can't prove it, but I just got faith.
Yeah.
That's what the Christians would say. So our founder laid it out, illustrated, so to show you as a way to prove the pattern and the purpose of Yahweh. Read.
And I want to tell you something else.
Uh-huh.
You must remain a skeptic.
Now, if you don't do these correlations and see the proof in this, then you're like that Christian. You're really a skeptic.
Right.
Even though you may say, I believe the Bible, but you're truly a skeptic because you can't prove it. Read.
Until you have some profound knowledge of these things.
Uh-huh.
It's a physical and mental impossibility for you to believe in something you don't know.
If you don't... The Christian, you can sit up and say, I believe in the Bible, but if you don't know it or can't prove it, then you're really a skeptic. This is what the founder is saying. I'm reading this. I'm not making this up.
Right. Yeah.
Read.
Believe in something you don't know anything about.
Uh-huh.
Now that's why we made these charts.
That's why we made the charts. Mm-hmm. So that you can see the evidence of this. That's why we correlate. So to put the Bible together in a way so it makes some sense and to show some proof. Okay? I don't know. I mean, this is really not a bad lecture. You know, and really, I almost started to play the audio because it's a very clear audio if you want to listen to it. You know, in fact, we played it once before, a couple of years ago, when Joe was around as well as Reggie. Because he had the... I had given him the audio of it. He played it one night. He played and played it from the beginning, because in the beginning it was, I think, Bud Winters on there. And he was the moderator, and he said, well, because Reggie got, remember, you can watch it. It's on our website. You can watch it. You know, where it just got up and said, now our next speaker will be the founder of the school, Dr. Henry Griffith Kennedy, and they played this audio. See? And then somebody gonna sit up and say, don't show me no transcript. Don't show me no pamphlet. Don't show me the textbook. I already know. You pegged. I know who you are, all right? So don't come to me with that. Just don't, okay? Because I ain't feeling you, really. Especially at this time of day, you know, when everybody want to come up with their own doctrine, right, their own interpretation, instead of going back to the witnesses. See, all right? Now, is there anything else I want out of this? Because it's a lot in this. This is enough right there. We can go back into our correlations.
Right.
Right? Now we had the scripture read lessons read. We had that. We got this plate up here. Mm-hmm. See, and the first couple of speakers belabored as far as Yahshua's mission.
Right.
Okay. His mission is to fulfill the scriptures. Now that means he's got to perform everything that is in the scriptures. Okay, the law and the prophets,
right,
if you will. And see, it was brought out how down here there was a lamb that was taken out And this became the origin of the Passover, and there was a death here. That death is reflective of the death here, when Elohim took on shape and form, right? And then the creation come out. There had to be an exodus from pure spirit, then the creation. That's mirrored here by the pattern. This is the migratory pattern. Egypt, wilderness, Canaan's land. It is a representation of the greater and more perfect sanctuary, which is the universe.
Right.
Here you have the death here of the Lamb. See, then you have an exodus. And after that, you have the Genesis. Moses comes up and he sees the Genesis. You have to have an exodus before there's a Genesis. Mm-hmm. And that's the death. And it was brought out how the Israelites were baptized in the cloud and in the sea. Let's come over here. We'll go back to the scripture lesson. Here. Baptized in the cloud and in the sea. And here's John here baptizing Yahshua.
Right,
that's a fulfillment of that. See, where's that scripture at? Out of Egypt have I called my son. Is that Hosea, I think? Because when John, look, here, the whole body of Israel was baptized in the cloud and in the sea, but they did not get wet. The Egyptians, they got baptized in the sea too.
Right.
And they did get wet.
Yeah.
And they came up dead.
Right.
On the other side of the shore. All right. So, but the whole body of Israel is represented here by Yahshua the Messiah. Because when he baptized, all of Israel is baptized. Now, of course, John the Baptist is baptizing everybody. In fact, Yahshua's disciples were baptizing too. In fact, the scripture says that they were baptizing more than John the Baptist baptizing. Do we have that scripture?
11:1.
Uh-huh.
When Israel was a child, then I loved him and called my son out of Egypt.
Called my son out of Egypt. All right. Yahshua is fulfilling that. All right. Let's go to the scripture lesson. I think it's the fourth chapter, but I think it's the last verse in Matthew 3:13. I mean not 13, but maybe somewhere around there.
You want the last verse?
What does it say?
And there followed him great multitudes of people.
In the third chapter?
And lo, a voice from heaven saying?
Yes.
Okay. And lo, a voice from heaven saying, this is my beloved son in whom I am well pleased.
Go above that. This.
Okay. So was it Yahshua when he was baptized?
No, just a verse above what you just read.
That's what
it is, Yahshua? Yes, Yahshua when he was baptized. Okay, go ahead.
Yahshua, when he was baptized, went up straightway out of the water. And lo, the heavens were open unto him.
The heavens were open. What? The heavens are open. Why were the heavens open? Draw a line. Because the Red Sea opened.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, read.
And he saw the Spirit of Yahweh descend like a dove.
Uh-huh.
And lightning upon him.
And see, like a dove and lightning upon him. And the dove remained. The dove remained. Not like, let's draw a line over here. We don't have them up here. 20. The dove remained, not like this raven here. Remember when Noah was cast out? What did the raven do?
It left.
It went to and fro.
Right.
It did not remain. Neither did it come back.
Right.
Because it was literally in a type of being cast out. But here, the dove landed on Yahshua and remained. Okay, keep reading.
And lo, a voice from heaven saying, this is my beloved son, in whom I am well pleased.
Mm-hmm.
Then was Yahshua led up of the Spirit into the wilderness to be tested of the adversary.
Now he was led up by the Spirit. Let's draw a line. Israel was led up by the cloud.
Right.
Mm-hmm. See, a phenomenal cloud into the wilderness. A cloud by day, a pillar of fire by night. See, this is what correlation is. Because we're showing what happened with the Israelites, and was showing Yahshua fulfilling it and proving that it did happen.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? Read.
And after he had fasted 40 days and 40 nights, he was hungry.
Now, why is he out here 40? He's out here in the wilderness of Judea. 40 days and 40 nights. Why is he out here 40 days and 40 nights? Let's draw a line. Because the Israelites are out here in the wilderness of Sinai. And they're out here for 40 years. See? Well, I thought it was 40 days. What about 40? Well, see, it's a day for a year. They were punished. That's why they were out here for 40 years. See, they had sent 12 spies up here, and they spent 40 days spying out the land. Two of them came back with a good report. The other 10 came back with a not so good. That made the people faint or lose faith.
Right.
Caused them to have unbelief. So Yahweh punished them a day for a year. And they ended up being 40 years out here in the wilderness. All right? Now, let's read.
And then the tempter came to him and said, if thou be the son of Yahweh, command these stones to be made bread.
Now, why is he saying that? There's a lot of reasons for that. See, why is he saying that? Now, in fact, I'm going to make you mad again because I'm going to quote from a pamphlet. Now, how about that? How are you feeling now? And the pamphlet is called, The Clergy Has Ignorantly Called Yahshua the Messiah a Liar, in saying that he instituted rather than fulfilled carnal ordinances. All right? Now, if you would just go to that pamphlet, and let's see. Turn to page 15 and start at the bottom.
When Joshua therefore commanded the Israelites to go to cross through the heat up water of the River Jordan.
Now she's reading a section in there that's called 12 stones at the River Jordan fulfilled by Joshua. Mm-hmm. See, now. Reason why that is, come over here. When they crossed the Jordan River back here, they had to take 12 stones out of the midst of this Jordan. Because the same thing happened here. That happened here. So they had to take 12 stones out of that, and it became a landmark out here. So when the devil is telling Yahshua, see these stones here, it's not just a bunch of rocks laying on the ground.
Nope.
This is a landmark. See, there are 12 gigantic stones out here that Satan is showing Joshua, saying, why don't you turn into bread? Go ahead and read.
When Joshua therefore commanded the Israelites to cross through the heaped up water of the River Jordan and enter into Canaan's land, he instructed them to take 12 stones and set them up at the spot in Gilgal, where they crossed over the river as a memorial to later generations of the epochal event. Likewise, after the baptism of the Messiah by John in the River Jordan, the Messiah goes into the wilderness of Judea to be tempted of the devil.
Now listen carefully. When Yahshua was baptized at, he was baptized in the Jordan. Where he was baptized at corresponds to the spot where the Israelites crossed over the Jordan into Canaan. See? Alright? So they were near this landmark that they had set up. Okay, read.
The devil seized these same stones, and he spoke to the Messiah thusly, if thou be the son of Yahweh, command that these stones be made bread.
Now, this why is he talking about bread? Where are we at according to the pattern? We're in the holy place. See, look at the pattern. Bread. Got the table of showbread here. Let's look at the migratory pattern. They had manna. From heaven, right?
Right.
That's the bread. He's fulfilling or performing that which happened with the Israelites on the migratory trip.
Right.
Thereby proving that it actually happened.
Mm-hmm.
Go ahead.
This reference to the stones, not just any stones, further points up the fact that Yahshua the Messiah was fulfilling, not instituting anything, the law and the prophets, for he had to be baptized in the exact spot in the Jordan River, mm-hmm. where Joshua and the Israelites crossed over on their way to Canaan land, mm-hmm. and had placed the stones there to mark the spot. Mm-hmm. As the Israelites journeyed through the wilderness, they murmured for bread. Then Yahweh Elohim rained down manna, mm-hmm. bread, from heaven for 40 years. When they crossed over the river Jordan into Canaan land, they ate of the fruit of the land, and the manna ceased. Heaven, which Canaan land is a type of, is where the bread came from.
Where the bread came from. That's why it ceased when they got there. Read.
The 12 stones represented the 12 tribes of Israel. Mm-hmm. Also, the 12 loaves of bread on the table of showbread.
Just like there were 12 loaves of bread here. Mm-hmm. There were 12 stones, and it was 12 stones that the Satan asked, told Yahweh, want to make them into bread. Mm-hmm. See, that correlates with the 12 stones, or 12 loaves of bread here. These 12 stones that Satan took, you know, wanted to see happen. Go ahead.
The table of showbread that was in the holy place of the tabernacle, mm-hmm. pointed to the Messiah and his 12 disciples. The Messiah, who was Yahweh manifested in the flesh, in that body abiding in heaven, which Canaan land was a type of, mm-hmm. was that true bread himself.
He was the true bread. See, read.
We have never read of any commentator, theologian, or otherwise who has ever explained why the devil made mention of some stones.
Because now they know it because they read the Bible, but what do they know?
Yeah.
They don't know anything. Ergo, they really are skeptics. Mm-hmm. They know what's, the world knows what's in the Bible, but can they prove what's right. in the Bible? Mm-hmm. No, they can't. Because they don't know this pattern.
Right.
Really that simple. That's what makes, that's the difference between us and everybody else on this planet, okay? Really. And then somebody want to come along and say, oh, you ain't got to do these correlations and stuff. You ought to know what that is. Come on. We got charts up in here. I mean, but some people believe that. And they think it's an art gallery. And they don't, and it's just a backdrop for their, that's, you know, that's called a soliloquy. You can look that up. You know, soliloquy, you know, I'm just here, just going on and on and on and on. The charts as a backdrop, the tools that you don't even use, you know. You're trying to build something without using the plan. It was brought out about you need the plan.
Right.
But here you are, you're trying to talk about something without using the plans. Okay. Now, are you going to be able to build it properly? Mm-hmm. I doubt it.
Oh, Lord.
I doubt that very seriously.
House guards.
Is there anything else in that section?
As all of them think that since the Messiah and the devil were in the wilderness of Judea, that there was, in all probability, a lot of stones mm-hmm. in the area, and they think, therefore, that the devil was just speaking of any stones, not realizing that the reference is made to the stones that Joshua commanded the Israelites to set up many years previously.
In other words, you ain't going to hear some Christian preacher talk about this.
Right.
Because they'll just think, oh, it's just a bunch of nail stones.
Yeah.
But we showed you by scripture and by pattern that those were not ordinary stones.
Right.
And the rhyme and the reason of why, because it pointed to the bread principle. All right, let's go back to the scripture.
Okay, a fourth verse. And he answered and said, is it written, man should not live by bread alone?
No, man should not live by bread alone, but read.
But by every word that proceeds out of the mouth of Yahweh.
See, that's your true bread. Mm-hmm. See, every word that proceeded out of the mouth of Yahweh. Read.
Then the adversary taketh him up into the holy city
uh-huh.
and set him down and set him upon a pinnacle
mm-hmm.
of the temple. And he said unto him, if thou be the son of Yahweh, cast thyself down,
mm-hmm.
for it is written, he shall give his angels charge concerning thee to guard thee in all thy ways, and in the hands of they shall bear thee up, lest at any time thou shalt dash his foot against a stone.
Now, Satan is quoting yeah. scripture to Joshua, so he knows the Bible. In fact, he knows the scriptures better than you.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? So it's no big deal to run into, because I have run into bibliomaniacs
mm-hmm.
in the world. I'm talking about Christian bibliomaniacs that could quote the Bible backwards and forwards and know what's in it. as far as what's written in it. Mm-hmm. But as far as what does it mean,
right.
That, you know, that's a big difference. Yeah. They really don't. Just like what we just showed you about the story. You're not going to find some Christian, you're not going to find any Christian minister that is going to explain to you right. about the stones in this story
right.
like the way we did. Because from the far as they're concerned, just a bunch of rocks. But we show you by pattern why it has to be that way. Okay? And so now he's on a pinnacle. What do you mean? Well, here's the pinnacle. It's the altar of incense. Because he said, well, the angels will intercede, you know, to catch you in case you fall. And see, and Joshua responds, read.
Joshua said unto him, is it not written again, thou shalt not tempt Yahweh the Elohim?
No, it's not, you know, since you quote scriptures to me, Satan, mm-hmm. you ought to know this one. Isn't it also written that thou shalt not tempt Yahweh thy Elohim? You ought to know that, since you know the other ones, you ought to know this one too. Okay? But hey, but that's his job. Mm-hmm. I'm saying that's his job to do that. But read.
And the adversary taketh him up into an exceeding high mountain.
Uh-huh.
And showed him all the kingdoms of the world and the glory of them.
Oh, that's too small. We got a big chart here. Yeah. Here they are. The kingdoms of the world, from Enoch, Tyre, Babel, Egypt, Assyria, Babylon, Medes and Persian, Greece, Rome, pagan and papal, England, America, the kingdoms of the whole world.
Right.
He's showing them to Yahshua in a vision. Let's get that right. Because this is happening in a vision. He's appearing to Yahshua in a vision, just like he appeared to Eve up here in a vision. He's appearing to Yahshua in a vision the same way. And he's showing Yahshua in a vision all the kingdoms of the world. And he says what?
And saith unto him, all these things will I give to thee, if thou wilt fall down and worship me.
Now see now, the Jews call that chutzpah. You know, it means unmitigated gall. And why I say that, because here's Satan to say, well, look, if you just get down, bow down and worship me, I will give you all of these kingdoms. Question, where did you get them from, Satan?
Right, right.
Where did you get them from? Huh? Wasn't it Yahweh Elohim that allowed you this? And then you're going to say, well, I'll give you all of this if you just bow down with me. I mean, that's some chutzpah. That's some gall. That's unmitigated gall. But he's created for that.
Right.
To be like that. Why? He has to be a worthy adversary.
Right.
Okay? But read.
Then Joshua then saith Joshua unto him, get hence, Satan, mm-hmm. for it is written, thou shalt worship Yahweh the Elohim,
mm-hmm.
and him only shall I serve.
Mm-hmm.
Then the adversary leaveth him, and behold, angels came and ministered unto him.
Angels came and ministered unto him. See, unto Yahweh. Why an angel? Was there an angel back here mm-hmm. in the cloud
right.
that ministered unto Moses?
Right.
Everything is a fulfillment of what's happening in the scriptures. Yahshua is fulfilling that. Okay, keep reading.
And when Joshua had heard that John was cast into prison, he departed into Galilee,
mm-hmm.
and leaving Nazareth, he came and dwelt in Capernaum,
mm-hmm.
which is upon the sea coast,
mm-hmm.
and in the borders of Zebulun and Naphtali, in fulfillment of that which was spoken by Isaiah the prophet, saying, the land of Zebulun and the land of Naphtali, by the way of the sea, beyond Jordan, Galilee, and of all the nations,
mm-hmm.
the people which walketh in darkness have seen great light.
They've seen great light. Why is he saying that? We got a chart. Right. Now, a Christian looks at that and say, oh, well, that light is Jesus. You know, that's what they would say. But we're showing you why it's that way according to a pattern. Great light. This is in the holy place. Why? Well, we told you. It was a cloud by day that they lived in, pillar of fire by night. In the holy place of the tabernacle, you have the lampstand here. See, this lampstand was lit at 3 o'clock in the evening,
right.
and it stayed lit until 9 o'clock the next day, because then the sun was shining.
Right.
You know, so there was never any darkness
right.
in the holy place, because they were faced east and faced the rising sun. Likewise, for 40 years, it was a cloud by day, a pillar of fire by light. There was never any darkness here. Okay, keep reading.
And to them which dwelt in the regions of the shadow of death,
mm-hmm.
light hath shined upon them.
Mm-hmm.
From that time, Joshua began to preach to say, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand.
Is at hand. Why is he saying is at hand? He's standing right in front of them. That's why it's at hand. He was the king. The kingdom of heaven is at hand. He's standing right in front of them.
He looked right past it.
Okay, read.
And Yahshua, walking by the Sea of Galilee, saw two brethren, Simon called Peter, and Andrew his brother, casting a net into the sea, for they were fishers.
Mm-hmm.
And he said unto them, follow me, and I will make you fishers of men.
Fishers of men. And they did what? Read.
And they straightway left their nets and followed him.
And just got up and followed him. I mean, look like, what? But that was the Spirit.
Right. Mm-hmm.
The Spirit talking to them. See, they were being obedient to that. But read. They were following Yahshua, just like these Israelites here was following that cloud. When the cloud moved, they moved.
Mm-hmm.
When the cloud stopped, they stopped. That's a fulfillment of that. They immediately followed Yahshua, meaning they followed the cloud. And you understand what I'm saying? It's a fulfillment of that. See? Because when this cloud stopped, that's when the Israelites had to assemble this tabernacle.
Right.
But when the cloud moved, they were like, oh, okay. They had to disassemble it and straightway, you know, let's get going, y'all. It's no different with you. When you decide to start walking, it's not like a delayed reaction. Okay, I need to walk over here, and there's like a 5-second delay, and then you start walking. No, you just, as soon as you think, well, I need to walk over here.
Yeah.
It just happens. Yeah. My body following my cloud, my brain.
That's right.
It's the same way here. Quickly, let's read.
And going on from thence, he saw two other brethren, James, the son of Zebedee, and John, his brother, in a ship from Zebedee, their father, mending their nets, and he called them, and they immediately left the ship.
And he left the ship, and they followed him, just like when the cloud leaves, they leave. They follow the cloud. That's why that's there. That's why it's on this plate. It's a principle, see? But a Christian would look at that and say, oh, well, Jesus had come, and they came. Not understanding or realizing why did they do that.
Right.
We can go back.
Right.
Because that's what they did back here. Following the cloud. When the cloud moved, they moved. Cloud said, let's go. They said, oh, okay. You understand?
Right.
Quickly.
And followed him. And Yahshua went about all Galilee teaching in their synagogues and preaching the gospel of the kingdom and healing all manners of sickness and all manners of disease among the people. And his fame went throughout all of Syria. And they brought unto him all sick people and that were taken with various disease and torment, and those which were possessed with demons, and those that were lunatics, and those that were paralytic, and he healed them. And he followed, and there followed him great multitudes of people from Galilee and from
Decapolis,
and from Jerusalem, and from Judea, and from the Jordan, beyond the Jordan.
From beyond, that's a very key word, from beyond the Jordan. In other words, from the other side of the Jordan. Yahshua walked everywhere, on both sides of the Jordan. And then when he came to the other side of the Jordan, Decapolis, you can look that on a map, an ancient map. That's on this side of the Jordan. So that when he wanted to cross back over the Jordan, he had a multitude of people with him. I'm talking about Joshua, the Messiah. Why? Because when Joshua crossed the river, there was a multitude of people that followed him.
Right.
That's a fulfillment of that. See? You say, well, how do you know that there was a multitude of people that followed Joshua, son of Nun, across the Jordan? Because there was a multitude of people that followed Joshua, the Messiah, across the Jordan. Just that simple. Read.
And seeing the multitude, he went up into the mountain. And when he was set, his disciples came unto him. And he opened his mouth and taught them, saying.
Okay, now hold it. Now, here we got, he went up to a mountain, and he was set. And the word is spelled S-E-T, correct?
Correct.
It didn't say when he was sit or sat, but where he was set. Why? Because, see, that's a fulfillment. See, Moses' first trip into the mount, what happened? They followed a phenomenal cloud out. That phenomenal cloud went and set on Mount Sinai. Moses was then told to come up. He was given instructions to give back to the people about clean yourselves up. In 3 days, I'm going to speak to you. Don't go against your wives. Don't touch the mountain. Put a border up. See? That's back here. How do you know that happened? Because this is what Yahshua did here. See, and we've told you often enough. We don't have time to really go through it today. But this is this plate, this baptism and ministry plate, this is a fulfillment of Moses' first trip into the mountain. Why? Because look over here. Moses, see what happened on Moses' trip. Elohim spoke from the mountain. What did he speak from the mountain? He spoke the Ten Commandments to them. All right? So now if he spoke the Ten Commandments to them, Yahshua's speech has got to be something similar. Go and find it. Where is it at in there? Because I'm out of time. Where it says, thus as thou say, come on, y'all. Y'all know what I'm talking about.
I'm 18.
Oh, no, I'll take
that back.
27. No, you're way down. Now, I want to get the preliminaries. The first one's first. You're way down there.
What do you want, think not?
No, no, where it says about, you have heard it say?
21.
Ye have heard that what was said of them the old time, thou shalt not commit murder.
Thou shalt not commit murder. Why is he saying that? Because that's what was said back here. Okay? Where's the other one at? I think y'all missed a couple myself.
No.
You sure? Okay.
27.
Okay.
Ye have heard that it was said of old time, thou shalt not commit adultery.
Thou shalt not commit adultery. Why is he saying that? Because it was said back here in from Mount Sinai. Okay, is there another one?
33,
okay. Alright.
Again, ye have heard that was said in old time.
Uh-huh.
Thou shalt not swear to a lie, but make an oath unto Yahweh thy oath.
Thou shalt not commit falsehood. That's what he said. Yahweh said the same thing, yeah.
38.
Right. What does it say?
And ye have heard that it was said of them, an eye for an eye, and a tooth for a tooth.
Uh-huh.
But I say unto you, that ye shall resist not, that ye resist not evil. But whosoever shall smite thee on thy right cheek, turn to him on the other side also.
Now,
on the other
side. Yahweh didn't say that. Because he quoted what Yahweh said, he said an eye for an eye. Because see, back here, with Noah, he said, whoever shall shed man's blood by man's blood shall, you know, you see what I'm saying? But Yahshua's saying, see, Yahshua's coming in now. He said, no. He said, why? He said, I'm going to forgive you. I'm going to turn the other cheek. Okay. Why? Because, see, here's Yahshua. I mean, Yahweh, he spoke this law down to Mount Sinai. And Israel, they committed all of this. They lied. They committed adultery, you know, and when they built this golden calf. So Yahweh punished them for it. But he did not get rid of all of Israel. Now, those 603,000 that came up out of here, see, they died of unbelief. And the new birth that was in here, they went on over. See, so that's Yahweh turning the other cheek. Because he could have just wiped them all out and said, the heck with y'all, be done with it. But he only got rid of those who disbelieved, and that new birth was allowed to come over. That's Yahshua fulfilling and turn the other cheek. In other words, I'll let this new birth happen. Because Yahweh could have just as easily just wiped the whole nation out and said, well, that's done, but I ain't gonna deal with these people no more. Go find some new ones.
Right.
But he didn't do that. He stuck with her. He stayed with her. See, despite that, even in the scriptures, they'll tell you that Israel was an adulterous woman, but Yahweh stuck to it.
Right.
He cleaned her, he did. See? So that, because of the love of Yahweh, it's so strong. It's strong as death. We went through that one session, see? It's strong as death, see? And the thing about it is, you have to know, to understand it more perfectly, this is why these charts were made. This is why you correlate, so that you can put the Bible together in a way that makes some sense, see? And not be a skeptic like the Christians. They don't know they're skeptics because, like was brought out, you know, by the previous speaker, where they would ask the person about spirit. Well, God is spirit. And as far as they were concerned, that was all the proof they needed.
Yeah, because it sounds good.
Because it sounded good, sounds convincing.
Yeah.
Until you really examine it. That's why these charts are made. That's why we can say we are not like any other organization on the planet as far as what we do with this doctrine,
right,
and how we present it. That's what makes us unique. And I'll go and say this, that is what makes us essential. Not us as people, but this doctrine for your salvation, for your eternal life. That is essential.
Right.
Okay? We thank you for tuning in. Thank you, folks, for coming. Good to see our president again. Glad everything's okay back at home. And we will continue with this as long as the law allows. You know, I mean, if the police come in here and say we got to shut down, then we'll shut down. But right now, as I spoke to them folks, they said, look, as long as y'all adhere to strict health guidelines and such, you know, and there's only a few of us in here now. Yeah, I'm not going to give you that. Yeah, there's only a few of us in here, but we don't mind people coming, but if it's beyond 10, then we have to turn you away. So we simply ask you just refrain. Though those who do come in, we have committed ourselves to do this, and you know, no matter what happens, you know, I mean, we could get sick. I could easily get sick and die, all right? But I don't mind, because I'm doing what Yahweh wants us to do, man. He wants us to preach, and we will survive this, you know. And there's nothing wrong with, and if it gets to a point we have to adjust, we will adjust. We've done it before. But until that day comes, we'll just keep on keeping on as the way Yahweh's allowed us to do. So we thank you for being with us in this journey, okay? Be safe. Be healthy, but most important, be in Yahshua.
Right.
And with those few words, thank you. And all praises go to Yahshua the Messiah. Thank you.
Alrighty, that concludes today's lectures. Thoroughly enjoyed these class today, speakers. Thank you for tuning in out there, brethren out there in Ensenada, to Mexico, and all over the place, all over the world. Okay, any announcements? No announcements? Okay, we have classes here Sundays 11 to 1, Tuesdays and Thursdays 7:30 to 9:30. All donations can be had by Dr. Hughes Reiser, our secretary. Let's all stand and be dismissed. Now unto him that is able to keep you from falling and present you faultless with his presence with exceeding joy. To the only wise Elohim, our Savior, through Yahshua the Messiah, sovereign, belong glory, majesty, dominion, and power, both for all time, now and ever. Let us all say,
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Thank you.